This Tibet House video was originally recorded at Menla Retreat in Phoenicia, New York, March 2017. To learn more about this annual program, please visit menla.us.
We're going to imitate Avalokiteshvara in the Heart Sutra that we just read, where we're going to look at our own five body-mind processes with our internal kind of scanning mentality. Okay? So the first thing we're going to look through, is our material processes. In this way we do a body scan, which in a way means we move our mind around in what we feel to be our body, in its present situation, sitting in an upright meditative pose. And in inventorying that, of course, it has to do with how much a notion of anatomy we have, and organs and muscles and tendons and ligaments and flesh and blood, etc., the fluids, etc. But the point is, if we scan and the brain, you know, the synapses, the nervous system, etc., the point is that everything in the material process that we can imagine or kind of feel is relative. It, you know, the heart is pumping, the blood is circulating, the nervous impulses are resonating up and down the nervous system. If we look carefully, we do not find something that's us or is the body that doesn't change, that is a fixed thing, that is an absolute thing, that is more than just a real thing, it's a really real thing. There is a real body, yes, a bunch of relational material processes. If you get really refined in this, looking through matter, you can go into your model of atoms and molecules, cells and atoms and molecules. And then if you go into the atoms, remember that there's just a nucleus and the circulating electrons. And then you go into the nucleus or the electrons and you get into subatomic quantum particles. And then you go into the quantum particles and you get down to where you lose track of the particle because you don't know if it's a wave or a particle. And you can't really put your finger on it. It's elusive. So then, if you meditate on this, you don't really have to have your body disappear, fall into space or something. But there are spaces in your body, and your body is in space. And so, you just simply have to embrace the failure to find anything absolute in your body. Not relative, that means something that makes the body the real body. You sustain or you embrace that failure. And when you do, then that's you have recognized the emptiness of the body, the voidness of the body, at which moment you can very easily see its total relativity. Everything is interrelated, everything about your body is related to itself and to other things around it. There's no non-relational thing. Everything is empty of any non-relational intrinsic reality. Now that's with the body. But then, to do this meditation, you also recognize you have a sense of still yourself, your own presence, your own sort of point of view, something that seems persistently there, and you're the one who just recognizes it. That was the same you that began to do it about 10 minutes ago. There's this idea that, so well, is the feeling of me a kind of sensation, that you say? Is it a pleasure or is it painful to feel that I'm me? Or is it pleasant? Or is it sort of a numb thing? I'm just sort of feel, well, I'm me. I don't really reach to it, so it doesn't really feel like anything. Is there such a thing in our whole cloud or stream of sensations? Because if you start looking at your sensations, like your bottom on the floor, your knees or legs on the floor, your feet on the floor, your back against the back of wherever you're sitting, if you're sitting in the chair, your arms in a certain way, your palms lying one on another, you know, the wind around you, the feeling of your cloth, your clothes, and your body, and your skin, etc. Some of those feelings may be sort of pleasant, like you're pressed up and warming in a cool place. Some you don't sort of feel anything, you sort of think about the right side of my thigh, it doesn't, well, I sort of feel the pant leg that I focus on, but no, basically I don't really feel anything. That's a numbness. And then if I sit too long without moving, I can feel a little pain just from my weight, or the bone, or the seat, or whatever. So those are sensations, but they come and they go, don't they? They're kind of a swirling thing. So I wouldn't say there's a sensation of meanness, of boundness, a sensation of being bound. I wouldn't say it's neither a pleasure nor a pain nor a neutral thing. There's no such fixed sensation, in other words. Now I have realized the emptiness of my sensual aggregate or sensational aggregate or process. So then I go to a very subtle one to look at. We go to in meditating. And you look at your images in your mind and your notions and concepts. You know, like floor, building, window, glass, snow, you know, menla, you know, human being, me, you know, name, whatever it is. All of these things, all your words and images, concepts, they move in a process. If you hear your inner voice, in addition to listening to me, you have an inner voice saying, okay, now I should concentrate, I'm going to meditate, I'm going to look at my conceptions, my ideas, my images. When you look at the content of your mind, you kind of realize that, gee, when I was looking at my body, it was an image that I have of my knee tie and my knee and my calf and my shin bone, that I was sort of feeling the processing. I was kind of moving around in the mental picture of my body. Even right now, if I think of my big toe, I can kind of wiggle it and inhabit it in a way, but in a way I kind of have a picture of my big toe and I put my mind there. So the conceptual aggregate is very active. And then I have a concept of Bob, of sermon, of my name, of a human being, of whatever, my age, my sort of size. I have like a picture of myself. But that's, I have many pictures of myself. I change all the time. Gain weight, lose weight, get older, whatever, get energized, get tired. Is there any kind of idea of me that is a fixed idea that I try to bring myself back to be Bob? Actually, I can't really find even Bob itself. Is it in the B, in the A, in the B that you land on? Bob. Where's the Bob? The sound kind of comes apart also. So after a while, looking around inside the content of your mind, in your concepts and things, and your images, the pictures of the world you have in your mind, etc., you begin to realize that there is no fixed, stable concept that's really yours or that's there in the midst of your concepts. And when you realize that, you realize the emptiness, the voidness, of your conceptual process, of that particular level of your mental process. So then maybe you think, well, maybe the feeling of meanness is more deep. It's like, I'm really here, I'm me. There's a kind of a feeling of self-assertion, maybe some pride or confidence, or maybe sometimes when something is lurking, maybe paranoia. But is there an emotion that is the emotion of I'm being me, of I'm me? What kind of emotion is that? Is that a fixed thing? Or do I have surges of sort of confidence, or a surge of intimidation or fear, or a surge of excitement, or a surge of lethargy, you know, of crumbling into fatigue or whatever, where I start to look at my emotions and I realize they very much come and go, and there doesn't seem to be a fixed emotion of being me. So then when I realize that, when I sustain or embrace the failure to find a fixed emotion about me-ness, I then have realized the voidness of my emotions, of that level of my mental and physical processes. So then finally I come to my consciousness itself, and you come to your consciousness itself, and you realize that it's quite a complicated process. And you know, you have visual consciousness. When you look very intently at something, you might not hear somebody was saying to you. When you listen very intently, you might not see something in front of you. When you smell very intently, you might not see or hear, or you might only focus. So consciousness divides itself up and aligns itself with the five senses lots of the time when we're awake. And then sometimes it goes inward into the world of concepts and emotions, and sort of looks inward into our inner content, which is the sixth sense, the mental sense. And when I look at my five sense consciousnesses, I realize that they change very much, registering the smells or the textures or the forms or the sounds that they are focused on, that they are focused on. And therefore, they change according to their objects. Similarly, I look in my mental consciousness, and just as I realize there's like a voice in my mind that I think of as my voice, but it says, now time to get up, now time to go over there, and I'm in class, blah, blah, blah. Or some other thing. But that they come and go, there's no one fixed voice. And just like if I have a hoarse throat, my voice sounds different than when I have a regular, keep talking a regular way. So the inner voice is not really just always exactly the same. So, but maybe the inner listener, when I hear myself thinking, oh gee, why should I focus now, I gotta meditate, or something. The listener who hears the voice recognizes it as uniquely my voice. I'm thinking. So there is where I have some place in myself that seems like a fixed identity. And this is the most difficult one that Avalokiteshvara faced when he was meditating on the illumination of the profound. He looked at that point of awareness that is the most receding, that if you recede in your consciousness back and back and back to sort of the root awareness, you come to this place where it seems to you that you're always just you. And so, but now you're looking and investigating to verify that. You're not just sort of letting it just seem. So you then turn back in that deep place to see, well, am I really here? And when you do turn back in the deep seat of your mind, you don't find anything here. You find the sensation of something backing you up. When you're looking out at your experience, at the world, or even your inner world or outer world. But when you turn back to see what's backing up, you don't see something that seems to be you. And then you say, oh, of course not, because I turned back to look at myself. When I did that, the looker turned away from being the object of being looked at. So I'm the one who's turned back. And then you go into a process, if you have a really good concentration, let's just imagine that for you. You go into a process of twirling and spinning, looking to find the real you in the deep seat of your consciousness. And what happens is you keep spinning, you get dizzy. And because you keep turning away from being found, and you get to where Descartes is, centuries ago, without any good thing. And then don't make the mistake, though, then, but then you do differently from him. What you do is you embrace the failure to find a real you inside a real Isa, a real Bob, a real Nina, a real Bo, a real whoever it is. You didn't find a second one in there. Of course, you were still you in your way you habitually are, but you didn't find anything that is guarantees the unchangeability in the deepest heart of yourself. So then you recognize the emptiness of the self, of yourself. And then you can cry out happily like Avalokiteshvara, oh, now I know that these five body, mind, processes, these five aggregates, as Buddhists call them, are empty of any intrinsic reality, or devoid, or void of any intrinsic substantiality, or any non-relative absolute core component. And he experiences that, of course, through embracing that. He experiences that as a freedom. But it's not a freedom by not being there. It's not a freedom of escaping somewhere else. It's a freedom to be fully present to relativity. It's a freedom to be deeply and fully engaged with all relationality as an inevitable process. That's what emptiness gives you. That's what this emptiness gives you, compassion. Because when you're this free of any sort of thing that might be alienated from the relational process, that means other beings, and other things and other beings, then your engagement with other beings becomes your absolute, if you will. Its relativity, changeability, up and down ability becomes your absolute. And therefore, it becomes your absolute concern that things go up, that things go better, that beings suffer less, that beings be happy. And that is your compassion and your love. This wisdom of relativity becomes your compassion and your love. That's why Avalokiteshvara was happy. And then that's why he told how he felt. You know, that everything is empty, all these things are empty. And there's that really key one at the end of that sort of list. He says there's no attainment. So in other words, when we imagine attaining some goal that we're attaining, we are imagining that this unchanging absolute self of ours will be what it will be that will be having the attainment. And somehow it'll be the absolute. It'll know it's absolute for sure. But he says there is no such attainment. And then he says, and there's also no non-attainment. And that's really important meaning, that just as we are, even with our ignorance, in our relativity, we are actually one with freedom, with emptiness, with nirvana, with everyone, Buddha. From a Buddha's point of view, we're the same as the Buddha. But, and so the task of the Buddha and our task is to discover that, to experience that for ourselves, because we don't experience that. We experience ourselves as something isolated and alienated. So, in a way, when you have some inkling of this, and I'm sure it doesn't necessarily take 10 years or something, of course it might take 100 years or 100 lifetimes to make it really deep and deep and deep, like Buddha or Avalokiteshvara. But one can kind of get it actually very easily, because it's very practical and realistic, actually. And so then this releases one's, to whatever degree one feels this kind of openness, and one overcomes one's feeling of isolation and alienation, to that degree one's compassion intensifies, which means one becomes more and more concerned with others. It becomes more natural to be concerned with others. It's like normal. Because the difference between self and other becomes more relative rather than sort of really real. As the old Geshe La used to say, my teacher used to say, people are not wrong when they think they're real. Where they go off is when they think they're really real. It's like that. So So we have to get used to being unreally real as a liberation, because when you're unreally real, it means that your reality is your relative being, and that means that you can make of yourself what you want, what you work at. And by other token, if you let yourself just go, then you will change in ways that you will not maybe be that happy with. So the idea is to channel yourself in ever, even in tiny little increments, in more and more positive ways. It becomes just a natural thing. And of course, the immediate way of channeling yourself in a more positive way is to channel yourself into love and compassion toward others, and being concerned for them and worrying about them and thinking about them and caring for them. Caring for them. That immediately improves one's quality of being and overcomes one's sense of alienation. Okay, ding. That's enough. Meditating. Okay, you want to leave now?
No. I just wanted a little, I thought a little step in would be helpful. It was really helpful.
I don't want to hold the whole time.
That was great. It was wonderful.
Not that I know about the time. I have no sense of time. At all. Once something is going, the wheel is turning. I wanted to look at this Mahatmya. I mean, maybe I can ask your comments. I can interview you about the Mahatmya. This is a thing called, it's called Devi Mahatmyam. Mahatmyam, like Mahatma Gandhi. Mahatmyam means greatness of soul, great soul being or great being. And Devi, of course, is the goddess. And the goddess is the great mother, right? So this is a poem. And the poem was written by Brahma. It's satisfying to feminist theologians, actually, in the West. The sort of story about it and so on, which I won't go into, but in this text. But it's written by Brahma, that is to say, by God, male God. And although Brahma is sort of beyond the normal, he's really quite an amazing being, Brahma is. Even though, from Buddhist point of view, he's not the creator, he's sort of what other people in India think is the creator. But here, the creator is paying homage to the mother. You see. So that's what the poem is about, the Mahatmya. So it goes, Tvam Svaha, Tvam Svadaha, Tvam Hi Vasatkaraha, Svadatmika, Sudatvam Akshare Nitye, Siddhamatratmika Stita. So he says, you are Svaha. So Svaha means all is well. And you are Svada, which means all is nurture. You are the power, Vashatkara, and you are the soul of sound, Swaratmika. Because in Indian cosmology, they are not so much into particles and atoms, although they have them, and they discern the infinite divisibility of atoms thousands of years before the quantum physicists ran into it, let's say. They did themselves, they figured it out. But some of them, not all of them, some Indians thought they were like indivisible atoms, particles like the Greeks. But Buddhists found out that they're infinitely divisible, and therefore ultimately there are no atoms. Atoms themselves are relative things only, relative sort of levels of structure. And but the universe is made up of sounds. It's language, and it says in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was the Book of John and the Christian scriptures. And the Sanskrit is totally like that. The universe comes from sound, from syllables, from mantras. And when the universe is in a state of dissolution, which it cyclically, a particular universe has cycles of complete destruction, dissolution after supernova sort of thing, and then it emerges again after some long period of time, and then it's manifest, and again it dissolves. So they have an idea like that. But when it dissolves, it's not like a bunch of atoms lying around not making a universe, or some infinite singularity or a black hole or whatever they think their Big Bang came from. What it is there are consonants, and vowels are separated from each other. So So consonants by themselves have no sound. So they can't make a sound. So you can't have a tree because the T and the R by themselves won't make a tree. You have to have the E that leaves from the top position. So a consonant is a dead thing, a vowel. And the way universe reemerges is the vowels come, pick up the consonants and start making things by making their mantras. That's how the mother recreates things. And that's why he says she's Swarat Mikar. She's the soul of sound. And this guy has essence of the threefold Om. It's not in the text. Siddhar Matra. Well, Siddhar Matra. Okay? So that's why the goddess is this kind of. She's the mantra goddess. Actually, in the Transcendent Wisdom, remember I said yesterday that there is a one syllable Transcendent Wisdom Sutra? It's a brilliant thing. We can get it in English actually, because Sanskrit is like our language. And that is that the one syllable Transcendent Wisdom Sutra, you can understand it, is just. Not long R, the short which is the primal vowel. And then also has a meaning of negation in Sanskrit. Like we have in Greek, you know, you say amoral, you know, aniconic, you put an A in front of it, it negates it. So it's emptiness in the sense of a pure negation of anything unconnected. And yet it's all created at the same time. And so that's so wisdom is also creative. Because, and why is it creative? Because the creativity is not just for the sake of creating worlds or like having more people who are around suffering. That's a useless kind of creation. The creation is to create situations in which beings that don't realize that the deep nature of reality is bliss, and is freedom, and is total satisfaction, and absolutely full. We don't know that in our struggling and suffering. It's creating places and situations that they can interact with one, they can discover their wisdom and compassion, they can relate. And of all the places of relating, from the point of view of the Great Mother Transcendent, the human is the best. It's very strange. And the reason it is that the human is very godlike compared to animals without language, or with only small, tiny, a few woofs and barks and woof-woofs, you know, but not real complex, you know, memory transmitting language. And so there's more freedom from that and less complete engagement in subsistence existence, you know, just eating something. Subsistence, livelihood. So the human is like that. And yet the human is vulnerable and sensitive and frightenable. Not like the gods who get really self-confident when they reach their heavenly place, but they come from heavenly human and animal. And then they become gods, and then they sort of forget their vulnerability, and they're smarter actually than humans. Gods are. They become gods because they've been more generous and more moral and more patient. And more kind, you know, but they get lazy, and because they're lazy, they don't want to try to understand the nature of the Great Mother. They don't want to understand reality. They don't want to join her team because they're just sort of happy to just lounge around in her kindness and not become a Great Mother themselves. You know, the idea of the Great Mother is.